Pleasure to be here. I want to begin by thanking Joelle and Diana, especially for showing me around, and the other members of the search committee that have showed me around. They've taken time out of their busy schedule to do that, and I really appreciate that. I want to thank those of you in attendance, but I especially want to thank the faculty and staff and students who have met with me, not only because they've taken time out of their schedule to meet with me when they're busy, but because of doing it four times. And I understand that that's a commitment. It's a time commitment, and I appreciate your dedication to the search and the university for doing that. But mostly, I would like to thank your interim president, Ed Flinche, for doing what he's doing. He didn't have to sign on to be interim president. He could just as easily stay in his comfortable home in Wichita and not be separated from his family, but it shows that commitment. I think that's sort of one of the special things about Emporia State University, so I want to thank him for that. So I want to make a few comments. I have a few notes. I just want to make a few brief comments and then answer questions. And I'll begin by saying that I was not historically not comfortable talking about myself. And so I was born and raised in a time and place in Kansas where you didn't talk, you just did things. So you just went out, you did your business, and you didn't brag on yourself, and you didn't talk about yourself, you let your actions do the talking. And I want to circle back to that at the end of my talk. So that's just an opening seed that I'm planting in my brief remarks. I'm from Wellington, Kansas. My father was a family physician there, and then everyone else in our family were farmers. Mostly in southwestern Kansas and northwestern Oklahoma. And I want to mention a little bit about my family and my personal biography, but only because I want to use it to highlight this point that I believe, which is the power and the transformative power and the historical power of education in the state and the importance of education in the state of Kansas. And so on my mother's side of the family, they were all educators. So my grandmother was a principal in Kansas and Oklahoma for 45 years. Her husband, my grandfather, whom I never knew, was a principal and superintendent in southwestern Kansas. My middle brother was for 20 or 25 years of the principal of Barrington Elementary in near Topeka. So on my mother's side of the family, I come from a long line of educators. My father came from a dirt poor family of Panhandle of Oklahoma residents in the Depression. His father was a gas station attendant who died on the eve of the Depression. His mother made ends meet by taking in other people's wash, and he, as a child, he contributed the family income by shining shoes, and we still have the shoe shine box that he used as a child. He, at the age of 17, joined the Navy after Pearl Harbor and fought in major battles in the Navy and both the Pacific and the Atlantic, and then fueled by the GI Bill, financed by the GI Bill, he went through undergraduate and medical school in 6 years. And so I tell you that because on that side of the family, I see the transformative power of education. So I come from a state, Kansas, that has historically made a commitment to education. I come from a family that has both a long time involvement in education, but also one side that was transformed by education. After I left Southwestern College with a degree in history, influenced by a professor, I knew I always wanted to be a historian. But because of the influence of a Spanish professor, became interested in Latin American history, went to the University of Wisconsin, got a PhD in Latin American history. The first course I ever took in Latin American history was as a graduate student. So at Southwestern College, we didn't have Latin American history, but I had the influence of this individual. And went on to a career as a professor and scholar of Brazil. Was fortunate to write two books, and the second one, which is a study of the construction of the telegraph line across the Amazon basin, won the best book prize in my field for the best book in Brazilian history. I've held in various administrative positions at the University of Tennessee and at the University of Massachusetts Amherst that have placed me in charge of student success, town gown relations, interactions with the legislature, developing and implementing strategic plans. These are some of the things I've done as a central administrator. Just a few remarks about my administrative style. I think I'm known as a good listener. Maybe because of my historical training, I find it exceptionally important to gather a lot of information and data and best practices before making decisions. And my goal in every action, and my goal in every decision, is not a total agreement, but that everyone leaves that room feeling that their side was listened to, that I considered carefully their contributions. We're not always going to agree, we're not always going to accept or fund a proposal that comes my way, but I do commit to that kind of a communication. I have experience explaining higher education to various publics. I think that's one of my strengths as a central administrator. Sometimes those of us who are in higher education, we take for granted our world. And we take for granted that people outside of our world understand it the way we do. And we take for granted that what we think is important, people outside the institution think important. But that's not the case. It's not realistic to think that that's the case. And so part of my career has been devoted to explaining to other publics what it is that we do in higher education. That would be town members, that would be town officials, that would be legislators. And I think that would be an important skill that I can bring to the position of ESU's president. I managed a generational shift in a department when I was the head of the history department. And so we were hiring 2 and 3 people a year for about 5 years. And so I think one of the experiences I bring to the table is hiring faculty and retaining them, figuring out what you have to do to get the faculty to accept your position and then thrive at your institution. And certainly have been involved at 2 universities in enrollment management. So I have served on the enrollment management committees at the University of Tennessee and at the University of Massachusetts. Now, I began by saying that I was raised in a place that emphasized doing and not talking, and was not comfortable talking about myself. And as I made my way into higher education, and as I began to interview for jobs, and as I began to compete for Fulbright fellowships and other honors and competitions, I realized that I had to start talking about myself. And I realized that even though actions are important and what you do is most important, sometimes you have to explain that to other people. That won't at the surface be immediately apparent. And so I became more and more comfortable in talking about myself. And I would suggest that Emporia State should become more comfortable talking about itself. And I see as one of my strengths and one of my roles as your president is to make us all more comfortable about sharing the good news of Emporia State. It's corny to say it, but I've been saying that I see my role is to be cheerleader in chief for Emporia State University. My impression of Emporia State was it's always been rock solid. My impression growing up in Wellington, Kansas was everybody who went to Emporia State got a great education. My experience is that my college roommate came here, forgot a master's degree in biology, and has had a great career with the Nature Conservancy. So my experience is Emporia State walks the walk. But now in today's world, Emporia State has to talk the talk as well. We have to explain to our publics what we do and why we do it and why it's important. And I think I can help there. And I'll finish by saying that I left Kansas, but Kansas never left me. And so throughout my career, I've always wanted to return to the state that gave so much to me. And I've always looked for an opportunity to come back and repay the citizens for the boost they gave to my life and to my career. And for all of these reasons, it would be my distinct honor to serve as the president of Emporia State University. So I'll stop there and answer questions to the best of my ability. Usually I detest talking with a mic, but my voice is starting to give out, so I beg your indulgence on that front. And if you have a question, Joelle will bring the microphone to you so that we can hear that.
you had made was that at Emporia State, you think of as a teacher's college, and we certainly hang our hat on that. I'm not part of the teacher's college, I'm a chemist. And I guess my question would be, what do you think we can do to help rebrand and bring in more than just the teacher's college?
Sure.
We are more than just a teacher's
college. You know, it's interesting because I didn't say anything about teacher's college, I don't think. But my point is that if Emporia State is very good at many things, and we need to celebrate that. Now, my success as an administrator, the success I've had as an administrator is built around this operating principle. We have to decide who we are, and then we have to be good at that. And deciding who we are and being good at that means that we have to decide that we cannot be all things to all people. So I have routinely focused on who are we, what's our mission, let's be very good at that. We cannot be all things to all people. And so when I was the head of the history department at Tennessee, we used to try to give a PhD in many different fields. That just meant we weren't good in any of them. We concentrated our resources on a narrower field. So I think you play to your strengths, and you determine what those strengths are based on the mission of the university, and you pay important attention to all the other disciplines. I'm from history. That's not often a discipline that's seen as central in some ways to what's important at a university, and I would assert it's extremely important at a university. Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
My pleasure.
How do you assess change and implement change? A new president model springs change, but how do you do that?
Well, first of all, let me say that the change that I've been involved in and experienced wasn't primarily or only a top-down change. And so I believe that in higher education, real change has to be some sort of mixture of guidance from above and participation coming the other way. So I'm at a university right now that's doing some exciting things with its general education program that's 100% bubbling up from the fact that that's not being directed from above. So my first answer to your question is, I think a leader is out there suggesting new avenues, suggesting ways to change or improve, but is doing that in an ongoing conversation with various publics, and can't have initially rigid and fixed ideas of how to do that. So it's a conversation, it's not a dictation, is how I would say that. How do I assess change? Maybe the question is, how do I assess whether what we're doing is effective, and the changes that we're making are effective? And depending on what you're doing, there are various evidentiary bases for that. National best practices, how are other universities doing it? Is it doing what we want it to do? We need some goals. I'm very much in favor of that. I can't give you one single answer because I think how you assess it changes with each individual endeavor.
I'd like to ask, what are you reading outside of your discipline, and what art have you looked at lately other than your wives?
So in art, Kim, what's her name, Wayman? Kim Soja. Soja, do you know that Korean video artist? There's an exhibit of her, a major exhibit of her work in our University of Massachusetts Fine Arts Gallery right now that I just find extremely interesting. And literally, this is kind of interesting, the Chancellor's Office at UMass has a collection of original prints for the Paris Review. There's one by Chuck Close, and there's one by Andy Warhol, and there's one, and these are original prints. So I look at those every day. Outside my discipline, it depends on whether you consider my discipline history or higher educational administration. So if you consider it higher educational administration, I'm about halfway through the Manning Marable's biography of Malcolm X, which is really great. So that's what I'm reading right now, and I try to always by a creative writing instructor at the University of the South, and it's about a family of performance artists that would always involve their kids in their performance art unwillingly, and then they grew up and they had to move back in with the family, and there were all kinds of resentments, and that's what I've been reading lately. I like that question.
How much importance do you put on successful athletic programs?
Well, I've always thought that athletics is one of the front porches of a university. Clark Kerr, the very famous Chancellor of the University of California, Berkeley, said that athletics is for the alumni, and in a way that's a bit of the case. It's a way to attract attention to the university. It's a way to, I've been at a university at Tennessee where athletics is extremely important. And that university has one of the strongest senses of community that I've ever witnessed in higher education. You go through the University of Tennessee and you are a volunteer, and you are a volunteer for life, and you can be living in Nome, Alaska, and you're going to have that game on, and you're going to be crying in your beer if they lose. And you're going to come back to the campus, and you're going to give money and donate to the campus. It just generates a tremendous sense of community. So I think athletics is an important front porch of the university. I'm at the University of Massachusetts where athletics is absolutely not important, and there's not that sense of community. I'm an ethnohistorian and not assert that there's necessarily a cause and effect, but it's a factual statement. Having said that, you can dirty your front porch very quickly with missteps in athletics. So any kind of scandal can destroy a lot of good work in a lot of other areas. And so you have to be very careful to have that front porch, wearing out this metaphor, and to keep it clean.
You've spoken favorably in a previous session of online distance learning off campus as a source of revenue. Now, the KU School of Pharmacy does not accept transfer courses in science labs, nor does the University of California Top Edition Berkeley Gang. In fact, not only science labs, but also performance courses such as debate and music and voice and theater and so on. And here we have a lot of science teachers. Can force this become a branch of Phoenix and Emporia, or can we continue to maintain our position that we need real labs and fieldwork? Because you have a friend who obviously was in fieldwork at Bond.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'm qualified to comment on that specific question of whether or not you can do laboratory work in distance ed. I'm a big fan of distance ed, and I think it's one of the great success stories at Emporia, and we should celebrate it. I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm a historian. And I haven't been at universities where it was done that way. So I can't answer that question I think your question is, can you do that, or should you do that, or will we do that? Yeah, and I'm a pretty big fan of getting people together in a room that know that world, preferably people that have difference of opinion, and work that out. I think there was a question right here.
I asked this question before, but the other man was here.
I hope I give a better answer.
Well, it's good. Will you be released from your other job? When?
Uh-huh.
If you're elected.
Well, I can start in January. Is that your question?
Yeah.
Yes. So balmy January.
So let's say you start in January, what will you accomplish, or what would you like to do your first 30 days?
Right, so my first 30 days won't be here. My first 30 days, whether I'm already on the payroll or not, will be in Amherst pouring over information about Emporia State. So the day that I accept the position, I'm going to make a call to the history department. I'm going to say, send me a one-volume history of Kansas. I need to brush up. I'm going to call up the School of Education and say, send me whatever journal articles you have on higher education in the state of Kansas. I need to bone up on that. I'm going to wear out, I've already warned her this, I'm going to wear out the Director of Institutional Research to send me all kinds of institutional research information. So, my first 30 days are going to be here. My first 30 days are going to be at night at my study in Amherst reading as much as I can, so that when I get here, I'm up to speed on the major issues and the major components and the major facts about the university. And as I've said in other venues, once I get here, and I wish I had invented this phrase and I didn't, but I'm going to borrow it, and that is I'm going to hit the ground listening. And so I have a minor in anthropology, and I'm enough of a student of anthropology to know that I need to learn how people see their world. I need to observe the rituals that people engage in. I need to think about what is important and not important, so that then I can start to help make some meaningful contribution to the university. At the same time, when I get here, without knowing any of that, I think I could be a pretty effective and aggressive spokesperson for the university, meeting with legislators, meeting with donors, meeting with alumni groups, and I would hope to do that from day one. Thanks.
Could you tell us what your experience has been with shared governance in an institution? Have you been on faculty senate or anything like that?
So I served on the faculty senate at the University of Tennessee, and the way it happened was I was on leave in Brazil for a year, and when I came back, I found out that the history department had voted me their faculty senator, and I enjoyed that experience, and that's when I was named chair of the athletic committee. I didn't know anything about that, but I had been a frequent critic of some things at Tennessee, and so that's what that's the appointment I received. I chaired that committee. And I watched the transformation in faculty governance at the University of Tennessee, and I was part of both sides of that. And so when I began in the Faculty Senate was basically a bomb throw. I mean, we were angry people, and we were unhappy with what we thought was a kind of a localized, uninspiring, and central administration that lacked an understanding of national trends in higher education. And so when they said red, we'd say green, they'd say go up, we'd say go down, they'd say yes, we'd say no, and that didn't get us very far. And I watched that transform when we hired a new chancellor at the University of Tennessee who came in, and he modeled the behavior that he expected from others, and that was transparency. That was clear, consistent, honest communication, and living up to his promises and expecting others to do the same. And over time, shared governance at Tennessee became an ongoing dialogue and conversation about what we can do to improve the university. And anytime we were talking about initiatives, anytime we were talking about major decisions, a lot of that was being discussed, especially in the executive committee of the faculty senate. Now, having said that, let me give a very brief, more technical answer that will only be of interest to the faculty, not to the general community here. Which is, I just reread the 1967 AUP document on faculty governance, and it says literally the faculty is essentially in charge of the academic enterprise, meaning especially curriculum and affiliated matters. And by being in charge, that is that the central administration will not overturn their authority and their decisions, and will do so, if ever, only sparingly and with great explanatory care. So take great care to explain those decisions. That's how I see shared governance.
ESU has struggled, obviously, the past 4 years with enrollment numbers declining. And while state funding continues to become a greater risk to all Regents universities, and our tuition continues to rise, what's the first issue that you would tackle here? Enrollment, tuition, expenses, costs, what do you see as the one issue that you think is your top priority if you were to become our president?
Yeah, you know, I appreciate that everybody's been very honest in talking to me about the issues facing Emporia State. I feel like if I'm honored enough to get the job, I'm not going to come in and having been sold a bill of goods. And it's interesting because we are searching for a new chancellor at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. And when the university system president came to visit, I said, "President Corrett, what can we do to help you run this search?" And he said, "Can you remind people that we're trying to actually attract someone and not always be negative?" I said, "Yeah, we can help you with that." But I feel like I've gotten an honest assessment of the challenges at Emporia State. I think enrollment management is on everybody's mind. That's something I have a lot of experience in tackling. And I think that's something that I can begin working on early. However, I don't mean this facetiously, and this may not mean much to the people in the community. I believe it will mean a lot to the faculty members. That's the job of the provost. So I have a lot of ideas about how to do that, and I'll be of great help. But I also am a believer firmly in delegating authorities and responsibilities and working with people who are directly hired to deal with those things. I have a lot of experience in enrollment, and would certainly see that as one of my first tasks.
Okay, you kind of touched on this earlier, but can you explain a little bit more in depth your experience in improving town and county relationships?
Sure. I'm in charge of town-county relations for the University of Massachusetts with the town of Amherst. And here, what I seek in that is regularized dialogue. And so in Amherst and with UMass, historically, they just didn't get together regularly. And I'm a big believer that you get together regularly. And issues that may not be on your radar screen because you're not getting together regularly, when you get together regularly, even if it's not a meeting about X, X might come up, and it's good to hear about that. Secondly, my own feeling on town-county relations is you always, and why wouldn't you look for this, win-win scenarios. So I feel like we're in a place now in Amherst where the university and town administrators are thinking about how we can cooperate to benefit both institutions. And my own personal feeling that the next frontier on that is to how do we address infrastructural needs together. So, for example, Amherst does not have, the University of Massachusetts does not have a world-class or national-class indoor swimming pool. It rained, it snowed a foot last week in Amherst. Okay? Last winter it snowed 80 inches. You'd think you'd have a decent indoor pool. But it doesn't make sense for the university to build one and then the town of Amherst to build one. And that would be an example. Maybe we could cooperate and do that together. So I look for win-win opportunities. I guess no candidate's going to say that they look for opportunities to stick it to the community. I recognize that. But I think my experience, and I can give you examples of where we've done that. And most recently, I was one of seven or eight people on a committee to create a business improvement district. And we just got that done. And that's going to really enhance the funding to make improvements to the look of the downtown. The whole special events will be attractive to our students to make the place look great so that when parents visit with their 17-year-olds, they'll get a great impression of not just the university, but of the town as well. So that's my approach to the town here. Thanks. Yeah, but you have to wait for the mic. That's the one there. I'll make sure it's up here. Yeah.
What level of importance would you place on student involvement and the residential experience?
And student involvement, the residential experience. Certainly in Tennessee and Massachusetts, we have highly developed residential academic programs that place students in residence halls together and they take their classes together as a one way to build a sense of community. I don't know if Emporia does that, but we've had great success with that. And another area of really great success is creating these supplemental instruction sections where students that are juniors and seniors who've got A's in beginning math and science courses hold supplemental, we pay them to hold supplemental sections to help students that are in those courses. Those are two examples of the experience I have in that. I think you could talk to students a long time and they'll get a certain amount, or you can have students talk to students for a much shorter time and they'll get a much different. Did you have a question? Because I promised I'd give you the microphone. Oh.
Can you share your vision, your international vision for Boise State University?
Yeah, I think that's another one of the great successes that maybe hasn't been touted enough at Emporia State. So roughly 10% of your undergraduate enrollment is international, 1% at UMass, which is a shame. When I attended Southwestern College, so I grew up in Little Wellington and I went 13 miles over Winfield, and that was when I first encountered international students. It's a fairly healthy international population then. And that enriched me as an individual, that helped me grow up as an individual, and it helped me realize that there's another world out there. And that's really kind of one of the transformational goals of higher education. So I think it's very important. I think Emporia State must be doing that very well because of the percentage of students that are here. And I would like to see that continue. My one goal would be to diversify the student, international student population. And only because when I was at Tennessee, we had several graduate departments whose enrollment was heavily slanted towards the residents of one country, and when there was political unrest in that country, literally from one day to the next, they lost their funding. And that really hurt us. That's the one observation. I'll listen to you, and I want you to go away from every one of those interactions feeling like I paid attention to you, to what you were saying, and I carefully considered the evidence that you presented. And that's about as much as I think any honest administrator can promise.
Pleased to have you on campus today.
My pleasure.
My name is Lana Lee, and I serve as the current chair of the Emporia State University Foundation. And I wanted to know what your experience is working with university foundations and with fundraising/friendraising.
Sure. First of all, thank you for your service to the university and to the state. It's people like you that really make the job attractive and Kansas attractive. I have a lot of experience with fundraising. I was really the first department head in the College of Arts and Sciences at Tennessee to see that as one of my major responsibilities. And I apologize for repetition because some people have heard this, but when I was a department head, we had underfunded non-competitive graduate stipends. And for 3 years I asked for more revenue or resources from the university to fix that. And I didn't get it. So I reached a point where either I could cry, or I could cry and then do something, or not even cry and do something. And so I chose the third option, and I said, I'm going to take advantage of this terrific development staff we have at Tennessee, and we're going to go out and raise the money. So we eventually raised enough money to add $1,000 or $2,000 a year to each one of our graduate stipends. That was my introduction to the power of development. Because of my faculty athletic representative duties, I was called on a lot to speak with development prospects in athletics. The Tennessee Athletics Department, the development activities then were headed by a man named John Curry, who's now the athletics director at Kansas State. And he was exceptionally good at bringing me in to talk to people who had only donated money to athletics and get them to donate to the academic side as well. And that was terrifically rewarding. So in today's world, we're just not going to go back to the era of the 60s and the state appropriations of the 60s. And so I would rather spend my time figuring out new sources of revenue, including development. I've seen how that can impact positively a university, and I would a big fan of that and would see that as one of my primary responsibilities as the president of Emporia State would be to be out there with the foundation, to be out there with the alumni, to be meeting with the supporters of the university, and to be encouraging them to continue their support, enhance their support, begin their support for the university.
Being a student here on campus, what would be some ways that you would try to connect with current students that are here on campus?
Are you a student here?
Yep, I'm a student here.
Where are you from?
I'm from Olathe, Kansas.
Olathe, Kansas.
And I'm a social science secondary ed major.
Great. If you're in higher education in general, and if you're in higher education administration in particular, and you don't like being around students, man, are you in the wrong business? I mean, I'm in a profession that I love. I get paid for doing this, which every once in a while strikes me as incredibly bizarre. You know, it's one of the great things about my career, and much of that is because I'm around people. They're young and they're learning, and I watch them and I help them grow, and then they come back 10 years later and I find out all these great things that they've done, and now they're ready to give back to their institution. So I like being around students. So I would look for regular opportunities to meet with students. You know, I'm enough of a kind of a hand that I wouldn't mind sitting in the student section at a basketball game. It's always been my number one goal in life to be the mascot under. So I've always wanted to be a student. I was always trying to talk somebody into letting me be Smokey. I never would. And then I've been trying to talk people into letting me be Sam the Minuteman at UMass. And I would love to strip my stuff as Porky. So, I mean, students are the whole reason we're here. That sounds trite, but sometimes we forget that because we get busy with a lot of difficult and complex issues. But when I'm looking for a way to recharge my batteries, that's one of the ways I do it.
With your different positions of enrollment management, what kind of experience and exposure have you had for specifically for recruitment or retention of minority students?
Right. I'm on the enrollment management committee at UMass, and we work very hard to do that. And so I created UMass Community College Connection. And that is a program that facilitates the transfer of community college graduates into the University of Massachusetts. And the reason I did that was because community college graduates in Massachusetts are a far more diverse body than our maybe four-year entering freshmen. And it is really one of the ways in our engineering department, almost all of this diversity comes from transfers from Springfield Technical Community College and other places. So that's one experience I have with promoting diversity and enrollment is by encouraging community colleges students to graduate. I and another individual at Tennessee started a bridge program to bring students from inner cities, basically the inner city of Memphis and the inner city of Nashville, for a summer bridge program to the University of Tennessee. The University of Tennessee was in an interesting situation in that it was very aggressive at recruiting for diversity and recruiting people from all socioeconomic strata, and then they'd bring them to campus and then they wouldn't do a darn thing for them. And it was sort of like, you know, it's sort of like redistributing land in the land reformation and not giving people seeds and fertilizer and tools and extension help. So we realized we had to do something about that. We created a program to bring 50 to 55 graduating seniors, and they would take 8 credits of work and get a lot of supplemental instruction because before we started doing that, those students weren't succeeding at the acceptable rate. So that's another experience I had in that field. Thanks.
About the importance of infrastructure, spending on that, and what it might appear to a prospective student.
Yeah, I have witnessed two building booms, one at Tennessee and one at UMass, and it's very similar in Emporia State in that both of those institutions went about 25 years without a single new building. And both of those institutions had about 60 to 70% of their building stock in buildings that were built between 1950 and 1970, which means that they were ugly and not well built and ending their useful life. So I have witnessed what a series of building projects can do to transform the appearance of the university and improve the quality of life of faculty. And I've, at Tennessee, witnessed the power of donations to make that happen. And as we struggle with the state appropriation, as we struggle with funding resources for our faculty and raises, one of the ways we can make everybody's life better is to try to raise funds and address those infrastructure issues. I've said this, so I apologize to others that have heard this, but when our son was looking at colleges and universities, it was maddening to me. But he, 5 minutes into the visit, you know, he'd driven like 8 hours. He'd driven overnight, he'd taken a red-eye flight to the West Coast. He'd walk on the campus, and in 5 minutes he'd say, "I'm not coming here. How on earth could you know? You've been here 5 minutes." But that was, first impression was very, very important to him. And we can, like it or not, but for 17-year-olds, that wow factor is something that they're going to pay attention to. And they're not paying attention to it just because they're not good students and they're superficial. We're talking about very accomplished students, but that's important. It's really, that's one of the important things that a university president can do is help with that infrastructural issue. Yeah.
I'm just kind of curious about what is your perception of Greek life on campus and what you think the goal is on campus.
Yeah, are you a student?
Yes.
And where are you from?
Ellsworth, Kansas. It's about like Salina.
Yeah. And what's your major?
Criminal fluency studies.
Okay. When I went to Southwestern College, we didn't have a Greek component to Southwestern. At Tennessee, it's very big. And when I was tasked with improving student success, I'll be honest with you, I never thought one. My brothers were in fraternities. Probably not the model. They're two fraternities. So I didn't really know much about it. And then when I started looking into which groups are successful academically, which groups have higher retention rates, the Greeks always came to the top. And when I started talking to Panhellenic people and the fraternity council people, I started to realize the importance of that community, that support group, that commitment to public service and the unity that brings. And so in short, what I learned was that Greeks can be a really important component to student success at a university. And that's when I really gained my appreciation for that. So Joella says I have 10 minutes and I can ask questions. But before I ask questions, let me introduce my wife, Moema Furtado. Would you stand up, please, Moema? Moema was very gracious to accompany me here. She's been in charge of Veterans Day activities with the Fine Arts Program at the University of Massachusetts, and that's in full gear right now, and so she took time out of that busy agenda to come here, and so thank you very much. We haven't seen much of each other, so it's nice to see you. Well, I guess I would like to hear what you want from a president. Any advice you want to give to me as a candidate, anything that you want to share about the university? And you're also free to ask questions. So if you have a question about me that you want me to answer, that's fine. So my question to you is: let me know what you want in the president, what you need me to know, want me to know. And then if you have a question that you want to answer, I'll keep doing that as well. And I'm going to embarrass my neighbor. So Karen, why don't you ask me? Why don't you try to answer one of those questions? So, what do I need to know? So Karen and I are neighbors in Amherst, believe it or not. She owns a house across the street from me, but she's a faculty member here. And I figured that out when I moved to Amherst. I was walking down my driveway and I saw this Kansas license plate. And I was like, wow, that's pretty bizarre. There's a Kansas license plate. So
while he was walking his dog and I was working my garden, we had many conversations. And I heard he was coming in here. I hoped he'd be a finalist, and so I'm very pleased about that.
Thank you, Karen. That's not why I called on you, by the way.
Just called on me to put me on the spot. I appreciate it. I guess my question is, because I'm a faculty member and a fellow historian, and I would wonder, and probably you answered this, I wasn't able to come to the back of the session, what do you envision is the role of faculty, and I don't mean just to teach, but in terms of what do you feel are responsibilities to the university in terms of that bugbear assessment, for example, and recruitment. Could you speak to those two issues?
Well, just as I said that, you know, a university couldn't exist without students, well, it would be pretty hard to exist without faculty as well. In a well-oiled, well-functioning university, there's that sense of community, and I think faculty want to tell, they want to spread the good news about their place. And I don't think it's not something you really force, but I do think that once you establish the right conditions, that it pops out. And I do think that faculty are especially important in recruiting students. It's that personal contact from a faculty member that can change their decision or set their decision to come here as a student. About assessment, I think we all, in today's world, if for no other reason, we have to figure out ways to demonstrate to the general public, to the citizens, to the state legislature, to the governor, we have to figure out ways to demonstrate them the value that we're adding. There's no common currency for that. There's no common language for that. But I think we have to make that commitment. That's a long-winded response to say that I think assessment is important, if for no other reason than that. Having said that, I don't think there's a one-size-fits-all assessment model, and I think that what works for business may not work for history. Having said that, that doesn't get people off the hook by saying, your model of assessment doesn't work for my discipline. My response to that is, okay, tell me what works for your discipline, and let's figure it out, and let's do it. But I think we have that responsibility to the state and the citizens, to demonstrate to them the value that we have. I just can't stand up here and tell you that there's one way to do that, because I don't think there's one way to do that. But I do think we should be committed to that. Sorry for putting you on the spot.
Yeah, my question is why and what do you say? What sets us apart?
In terms of why I'm interested in the position or why, I've always thought of Emporia State as really good at what it does and rock solid and a real treasure for the state. And my personal experience with people who attended this university has, in every case has been they've had a wildly positive experience at Emporia State. And why wouldn't that attract you as an administrator and as a candidate? I mean, that's one of the great things that you're looking for. Because, look, everybody faces problems. Morale problems, lack of raises problems, lack of infrastructure problems, infrastructural deficit problems, declining state appropriations problems. That's a consistent across higher education in America. What distinguishes the universities that are going to move forward in this environment, and from those that don't move forward, are some kind of foundational issues about a commitment to student success, a commitment to interaction with students, a commitment to the university, a feeling of family and community. And I think at that foundational level, Emporia State has that, and that's very attractive to me. So that's specifically my Emporia State. And then in more general terms, I just have this love for my home state, and I've always wanted to get back to Kansas, and would be really my distinct honor